thirsty? Are you empty? Come and drink these living water. Tired and broken, peace unspoken, rest beside these living water. Christ is calling, divine and refreshing.
Just a couple of announcements. Like last week, there'll be teas and coffees served after the service. Well, this seems really loud. it's slightly different from what it used to be because you'll need to wear your mask to go over to the table, but then if you can sit down with your coffee and enjoy some fellowship, you don't need to go back into the seat that you were in already, but you will need to be seated. The latest edition of the church newsletter is ready. They're on the table out there, if elders could collect them. There's quite a few elders not here today, so if some of you can maybe take them for other elders that you live nearby, then that would be really helpful. Next week, we're back here at our normal time of 10:45, and in 2 weeks' time, on the 19th of September, it's our harvest service, and like last year, we'll be celebrating harvest at Beaumains Farm rather than in the church. We had a great time last year. We had to stay in cars last year. I don't think we'll need to do that this year. So if you've got a folding chair that you can take and maybe a picnic, and then we can all enjoy the celebration and some time together. Thank you.
Thanks, Diane. Good morning. It's funny to see it a wee bit quieter again, but it's really lovely to see people here, and it's lovely to see faces that we've not seen for a while beginning to drift back again, so that's really lovely too, and a good morning as well, and a welcome to anybody who's watching us online, whether you're watching with us live or whether they're catching up later. Everybody's very welcome, and thank you, Ken, for telling me to take my mask off. So why not turn to the people round about you, if you haven't already, and say good morning, and tell them it's lovely to see them, or whatever you do. Our call to worship is up on the screen, and I invite you to follow along and to say the words in gold. Yeah? And there's a bit there in brackets where it says your name, so you have to say your name, right? And then follow me. So there's a wee test for you this morning. Can you actually get your name in the bit where it says your name? Jesus comes alongside us and calls us by name. A simple call, a hard call. And we look around to see who else Jesus could be talking to. It's hard to leave our nets and walk away from the lake. Let's sing together. Come, now is the time for worship.
Time to
We have come, and so let's come before God in prayer. Father, you call each one of us by name, and you have brought us here this morning to meet with you, to set aside time to sit, to rest in your presence. And so we come. And as we come, Lord, we are so aware of you, of being filled with wonder at your majesty, at your power, at your creativity. We're struck by the beauty of the world around us, where we see your creative hand at work most clearly. The colours of the sunset, the beauty of the leaves on the trees as they just begin to take on the merest hint of their ambers and golds. The wonder of the chill that's beginning to creep in the evenings and the dewy, misty mornings. The wonder of the love that radiates out of the faces of the people around us. who care about us. The wonder of your love in the cry of a tiny newborn baby. And the wonder of your love poured out for us in Jesus. Throughout his life, throughout his death, and in his resurrection. And Lord, the wonder that you call us, with all of our human frailties and failings, because we know the mistakes we make. We know the mess that we make of things. We know how desperately we want to do better. And yet still you call us. And you welcome us in as your children, beloved. And Father, for that reason we come and we give you our worship. For that reason we come and we bring you our praise. We sing of the wonder of that love, of the wonder of you, the God who loves us. And Father, we hear that call and we hesitate. And so forgive us for that hesitation. Forgive us when we look around at the things that we have in life and wonder what it might be to give it up. Forgive us for that moment of hesitation that we don't want to give it up. That we are comfortable with the way things are. Forgive us when we give in to the fear that we have of what following might mean, and so we stay put. Forgive us for the moments of indecision, where we know what it is that you're asking us to do, but we wonder why us, or we look around to see who else might be hearing that call too. Lord, for all of the times this week when we haven't followed, when we haven't acted in a way in which you've shown us before, a loving way, we say sorry for the sharp words, for our impatience, for the times when we've turned away, where our inaction has brought hurt and not just our action. Lord, teach us what it means to follow. May we sense your forgiveness. May we know it in your heart, in our hearts. May we find the courage to turn away, to turn to you, to give our lives fully to you, and to follow. Give us the courage and the trust to lift our foot and to take the next step in our lives with you. In Jesus' name, amen. I wonder if anybody's got any news this morning. And Ruth's hand shoots up. Let me just put my mask on. Lift my specs up. Get my microphone and then work out how to turn it on without specs on. There we are. Come on then, Ruth, what's your news?
two things. So today it's my granddad's birthday.
Happy birthday, Granddad.
And tomorrow I'm doing a big class talk.
You're doing a big class talk. What's your class talk on?
Scottish Wars of Independence.
The Scottish?
Wars of Independence.
The Scottish Wars of Independence. My goodness, that's a big talk, isn't it?
Yeah.
All about Robert the Bruce and William Wallace and all these.
Yeah.
Good. Are you looking forward to it?
Yeah, because I did it with my class on Friday, so I'm doing it next door.
All right. Good.
With my primary four teacher.
Oh, no pressure then, eh? You nervous?
Just a bit.
Just a bit.
In primary four, before I got to do my talk on the Vikings, lockdown struck, so I didn't get to do my presentation on the Vikings. So this is a first.
Yeah, it will be. Uh-huh. So that's a bit odd, isn't it? You've not done these kind of things now for 18 months, and here you are having to give class talks and everything again. Ooh, scary moment. I know how it feels even just to stand up there in front of everybody again after 18 months. Never mind.
To be honest, it was a personal choice I made.
Ah, good. You like to throw yourself into the deep end. Did you have your hand up, Hannah? Nope. Anybody else got some news? So we've got Ruth's granddad's birthday today, so happy birthday to granddad, who has played the accordion for us at our Kayleigh's. And I hope tomorrow, is it tomorrow that you're doing your talk? Hope tomorrow goes well. Anybody else got news? No, it's a quiet news day then, is it? Yep. Oh well, I just need to make you do some work then. You'll wish you had news. You're all very quiet this morning. So if we think about it these days, I mean, our theme this morning is following, in case you hadn't realised. Sorry, my nose is running again. I'm loaded with the cold this morning. One of my lovely children has smitted me. It is just a cold though, I promise. We've been tested, I know for sure. So if we think about it these days, we follow lots of different things. We follow people on social media. We follow trends. So, there should be a wee picture up on the screen, I hope. There we are. What are some of the people or things that you've followed? Maybe, you know, fashion, football, teams, bands, I don't know. Think about it. That's the first question. So have a wee chat with your neighbour about that, and then I'm going to give you another question. And if you've not got anybody sitting next to you, turn around, there might be somebody in a pew that's close enough to have a chat with. So what are some of the things that you've followed? Maybe back in the day you followed the Bay City Rollers and you went to all of their concerts. Or maybe you were there when Elvis touched down at Prestwick Airport. Or who knows, what are some of the things that you have followed? Maybe you've been to every single one of Bowness United's football matches. I better put my mask on if I'm coming that close, eh? Right, so what have you got? You've gone quiet, so I'm presuming you've got some answers.
I have a list of things I follow.
You've got a list of things you follow. Why does that not surprise me?
Little Mix, Rebecca Zamolo, Dangy Bros, England football team, Newcastle, and Dortmund.
Excellent. So some of those will be like YouTube video type people, yep, vloggers, things like that. Okay, different teams.
Lemon likes doing tricks.
Lemon likes doing tricks. And what do you like to follow what he does, or are there things that you follow, like what Ruth does on YouTube and things?
LOLs.
What was that?
LOLs.
LOLs. What are LOLs?
Laugh out loud.
Laugh out loud. Right.
Little dolls.
Ah. Wee characters. Excellent. The things move so fast. Anybody else? Come on then. What are some of the things that you follow? Come on, you were all chatting to one another. Don't be shy. Thank you, Margaret.
I follow my family on Facebook because if I didn't, I wouldn't have seen my wee great-granddaughter growing up and developing.
Lovely. So yeah, so actually social media has been quite good for that over the months, hasn't it? I've been able to see and share photos and things. So yeah, you follow your family on social media. Anybody else follow something?
I follow my family on social media. FaceTime, follow my family on FaceTime.
Follow your family on social media and on FaceTime, good. Anything else? What else do you, doesn't need to be on social media, what have you followed over the years? Craft, yep, different craft things. Going to craft fairs, things like that.
Wool shops.
Good. Different activities. Sanctuary First. Good. So lots of different ideas for things to follow. So yeah, we can follow things to do with our family. We can follow things to do with different interests that we have. Or maybe in the case of particularly Ruth, probably in some of the vlogging that she's watching on YouTube, it's people who influence us. We would follow them as well. And I suppose in the days now of social media, it's an awful lot easier to follow these people and to keep up with them because it's there on our phones, it's there on our computers, just at the flick of a screen. Right, here's my next question. What does it mean to follow someone? Have a chat with that about your neighbour. What does it mean to follow someone? If you don't have a neighbour to chat about it with, just have a think to yourself. What does it mean to follow someone? Right, Ruth, you can tell us first, your hands up.
To follow somebody's story or naturally follow them.
to follow someone's story or?
To naturally follow them.
To literally follow them. Yeah, you could walk along behind them, do what they do. You know, follow my leader. Anybody else? Pat's going to make me work this morning, come round this way.
I follow your posts on Facebook because I see parts of Scotland I've never seen before. from the top of a mountain.
Yeah, if you follow me on Facebook, you tend to see parts of Scotland you've never seen before from the top of a mountain. Good. Moira?
I follow my family, what their jobs are doing, how their life's going. Anything like that, follow the family.
So you find out about them, so what it means to follow them is to kind of find out more about them, okay? Anybody else? Oh, Diane over there. Don't have the energy to run this morning. I'll just walk.
If you follow someone, you're influenced by them.
Yeah, so if you follow someone, you're influenced by them. It might encourage you to do some of the things that they do or to behave in the way that they behave. In Matthew's Gospel, some of the first words recorded by Jesus is the invitation that Jesus gives to the fishermen to follow. So the first recorded words where Jesus speaks to somebody else, not to John the Baptist, but to somebody else, is to the fisherman that he meets on the shore. And so let's hear from God's word as Moira reads for us from Matthew chapter 4.
So the reading this morning is from Matthew chapter 4, reading verses 12 to 22. Jesus begins his work in Galilee. When Jesus heard that John had been put in prison, he went away to Galilee. He did not stay in Nazareth, but went to live in Capernaum, a town by Lake Galilee, in the territory of Zebulun and Naphtali. This was done to make what the prophet Isaiah had said come true. Land of Zebulun and land of Naphtali, on the road to the sea, on the other side of the Jordan, Galilee, land of the Gentiles. The people who live in darkness will see a great light. On those who live in the dark land of death, the light will shine. From that time, Jesus began to preach his message. Turn away from your sins, because the kingdom of heaven is near. Jesus calls four fishermen. As Jesus walked along the shore of Lake Galilee, he saw two brothers who were fishermen, Simon, called Peter, and his brother Andrew, catching fish in the lake with a net. Jesus said to them, "Come with me, and I will teach you to catch men." At once they left their nets and went with him. He went on and saw two other brothers, James and John, the sons of Zebedee. They were in their boat with their father Zebedee, getting their nets ready. Jesus called them, and at once they left the boat and their father and went with him. Amen to this reading.
Thank you, Moira. It's interesting. If we read of those same events in Luke's Gospel, we find the disciples responding to Jesus' call after they've seen Jesus at work, healing Simon Peter's mother-in-law and healing many others, and after he's helped the disciples with a miraculous catch of fish. And you can see why people might follow somebody after seeing them do things like that, can't you? If somebody healed your mother-in-law, they've proven themselves to you in some way, endeared themselves to you, and your interest and your inquisitive in them might be piqued. You might wonder who this is and want to know more. And it would be natural to follow and to have some of your questions answered. You would see for yourself. And well, if you've seen Jesus do that, then he looks like someone who might be worth following, doesn't he? I mean, who wouldn't want to follow someone who can heal folks and do miracles? And you wouldn't want to miss out on any of the action. And yet, as we've just heard Moira read in Matthew's Gospel, and also in Mark's Gospel, this takes place. Jesus calls the disciples before any miraculous public events have taken place. So before Jesus walks along the seashore and calls the fishermen to come to him and follow him, nothing has happened. He's literally just walked out of the desert after the devil had been tempting him and come to Capernaum. There are no miracles, no healings. In fact, it seems as though this relatively unknown guy just walks into town, the carpenter's son from Nazareth, and he chats to the first people that he encounters, some fishermen casting their nets on the shore. Hardly surprising, really, in this seaside town. Simon, known as Peter, and his brother Andrew, two men doing what fishermen did, standing on the shoreline, casting their nets into the sea, hoping against hope for a catch. And it seems Jesus says nothing else to them except, "Come and follow me, and I will take that skill you have of fishing, and I will make you fishers of people." I think, have we got another slide, or have I put down the wrong cue? There we are. Going further, Jesus sees two other brothers, James and John, in a boat with their father Zebedee. And as they prepare their nets for casting, Jesus calls to them. presumably the same thing, come and follow me. And we're told that in both cases, the response of the fisherman is the same, and it's immediate. There's no time to waste, no questions asked. They follow, leave their jobs, their livelihood, their families, without any suggestion of how they'll be provided for, and without any promise of what the future will be like. And they do it. Our Bibles say, and they followed. Jesus turns the way that things normally happen on their head. Not that that will surprise us, though, I'm sure. Because in those days, it wasn't unusual for young men to follow the teachings of a rabbi. Most of them did. What was unusual, though, was the way that Jesus did it. Because normally the young men would listen to a few different teachers, and then they would choose the one to follow who appealed to them most. And if we were looking to follow somebody, that's probably what we would do. And yet here, Jesus flips that. He turns it on his head. Because Jesus goes and chooses them. We might wonder why Jesus chooses them. Well, it's not because of any wealth or any attributes that they seem to display. Because Simon and Andrew, James and John are neither rich nor influential that we know of. They were just regular folks like you and me, engaged in the main source of income in that area, the main source of income of the day in that area. They were fishermen on the shore. And it's them that Jesus chooses. Not the rabbis or the scribes or the Pharisees, the ones who seem to be at the top of society and claim to get it right, or to be the most godly or the most perfect or the most pure. Nope, it's just ordinary folk. That's who Jesus invites to follow, to learn from him. Why? Well, John's gospel says, I chose you, if you remember, that you might go and bear fruit. And so Jesus chooses the men for a purpose. They're not chosen because they're going to go and be saved or anything like that. They're not chosen to go to heaven. Rather, they are chosen for a purpose in the here and now. And the purpose is to fish for people, Jesus tells them. These four ordinary men aren't given any titles in Matthew's gospel. They're not called apostles or anything else. They're only known by their names. And yet, they are given an awesome job in God's mission in the world. They're called to be part of what God is doing. Jesus wants them to go and be fishers of people, to use the skills that they already have and to go and use them in the work of God's kingdom. They're called to leave their old ways behind and to follow in a new way and for a new purpose, and to learn from the Master himself. And so think about it. Following Jesus. Imagine it. Picture the scene. If you were called in that moment to follow, what are you going to see? Over the course of his lifetime, you would see Jesus praying. Jesus teaching, Jesus acting, Jesus loving, Jesus healing. The list goes on. These men in that account in Matthew's gospel, they're just the same as us. Each one of us here today, whether we're here in the sanctuary or whether we're watching online. And each one of us has been invited to follow. Invited to learn from Jesus, to journey with Jesus. And each of us has been given a purpose. That same purpose, to fish for people. But we use the gifts that we have to do it. To live our lives in the ways of Jesus, and in doing that, to join in with God in the bringing in of God's kingdom. I spent my study leave in July thinking about renewal and beginning to study and try to understand what it might mean to renew our church. And what did I learn, you might ask? What am I going to do? Well, what I learned is that it isn't just something that I can do, but that renewal is something that's up to each and every one of us. Because each one of us, as individuals, is called by Jesus to follow. Each one of us is called as an individual to leave behind our old world and enter into the new world or the new way of being that Jesus invites us to. And each and every one of us is invited to go and fish for people. Not by manipulating them or telling them that they need to or should come to church, but by sharing God's kingdom with them, simply by loving them. That thing that we were talking about last week, acting for their benefit and without expecting anything in return. By praying for them and by ministering God's love to them in all of our dealings with them. Letting God's light shine out of us before all. Living our faith in an adventurous way that's exciting enough to be contagious. Just as Jesus called those fishermen to go and to leave their nets, their livelihood, everything else behind, so Jesus calls each one of us, you and me, to leave our nets, to go without question, to trust that Jesus will provide all that we need, the courage, the strength, to love. What are the nets that Jesus is calling you to leave behind? What is Jesus asking you to use in the work of renewal and the work of growing the kingdom? Have you got what it takes? Let's stand and sing, Lord, You Have Come to the Seashore. Let's pray as we dedicate our offering. Father, you are so good and so gracious to each one of us. Our lives are full of many gifts, which so often we don't even see. So we thank you for the gift of family and friends and home. We ask that you would accept these offerings of our money, along with our time and our talents, our very selves, Lord, that we might be used along with them in the growing of your kingdom, of the bringing in of your kingdom here on earth. Lord, use us. Open our eyes to the ways that we can be at work following your footsteps. Open our eyes to the ways that you are at work in our world today, and let us see where you are inviting us to join in, and give us the courage to follow. In Jesus' name, amen. I'm going to invite Diane now to lead us in our prayers for others.
Let's join together in our prayers for others. Loving, faithful God, we come to you with our prayers for others at a time when there is so much trouble and anguish in the world that we feel helpless, seeing the heartache of others, not knowing how we can help. But we are thankful that we can turn to you in prayer. Our media is filled with images and stories of people fleeing their homelands, places devastated by earthquake and weather extremes, war-torn countries, and people who live in fear under oppressive regimes. We don't know what it's like to lose everything, to flee from our home country, to be left with nothing, and our hearts go out to all who suffer. Lord, bring hope and courage. We pray for the people of Afghanistan, for all who have fled their homeland. May they receive a warm welcome in the countries where they settle. And we pray for all the local authorities and agencies who provide support. We remember those who have been left behind and are still desperately trying to find a way of leaving, and for all who will remain in Afghanistan. We pray especially for the women and children who live in fear that the Taliban will deny them their basic rights of freedom and education. Lord, we pray for peace and that all Afghan people will be treated with dignity and respect. We pray for the people of Haiti as they try to recover from the recent earthquake which has devastated their country, and for the war-torn Tigray region of Ethiopia, and pray that much-needed humanitarian aid will reach those in need. We give thanks for Christian Aid, Tear Fund, and other aid agencies who work to ease the plight of people in desperate need. We pray too for the people of Louisiana and New York, where areas have been devastated by Hurricane Ida, lives lost and homes destroyed. In recent weeks, our media has carried many stories of extreme weather conditions and the devastating effects of flooding and fires. Lord, help us all to look after the planet, the beautiful world you created, now under threat from climate change. Lord, we pray for action by our world leaders and governments, and that we will all play our part to protect the environment. And we pray for all whose stories have not made the headlines, for all who suffer without feeling able to tell anyone or seek help. those who suffer from abusive or controlling relationships, who feel trapped in their domestic situations, those afflicted by addictions or poverty, and who long to be free. Lord, bring courage, hope, and support so that they can make changes and build a brighter future. And we pray for all who are ill or anxious, all who have been bereaved, all who grieve, and all who are carers for loved ones. Lord, sometimes the road ahead seems hard and long, but you are always with us, lifting us up when we are weary. However hard life seems, Lord, help us always to look for the rainbow after the storm. And we take a moment of silence now to pray for ourselves and our loved ones, and for all known to us who we're worried about. And we join together now in the words Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power and the glory forever. Loving, faithful God, who is with us always, we give you our prayers in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you, Diane. Can we bring our service to a close? Reminder though that there is tea and coffee after the service if you wish to stay and enjoy some fellowship with one another. Let's stand and sing, Will You Come and Follow Me? As you go from this place, go and follow. Follow where Christ leads. Act in the ways that Christ acts, and love in the ways of Christ. And may the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with you, strengthening you and encouraging you, leading you as you go this day and for all of your tomorrows. Amen.
Unto Jesus be all glory.